Thank you for being here, folks, on this wet, cold opening of the Chapel Hill winter. I've long noted that about November 12th, it begins to drizzle, and that continues except for a few days around Christmas until February the 12th. So, welcome to the winter in Chapel Hill. I'm going to read you three relatively short passages from this book, and we'll be glad to answer any questions about how it came to be, if there are any. Two men rise from the North Carolina lowlands and find their separate ways into the 19th century maritime world. The wind that blows and the ship that goes carry them both, though at different times and well apart, to Norfolk, to Philadelphia, to Boston, New York, to the Caribbean and Mediterranean seas. One is an African-American born a slave in northeastern North Carolina. The other an Irish-American born at sea in the North Atlantic. And both proved to be men of great skill on many waters. Men of much courage and bearing, accomplished mariners, captains. Between them, their lives fall across the first century of the Republic, and their tales are those of illimitable, striving human spirit, and also of human bondage and destruction, and the great divide that nearly sundered a nation. Their fates could hardly have differed more. This is a passage about John Newland Maffitt. 50 degrees north latitude, 40 degrees west longitude, February 22nd, 1819. All three masts, fore, main, and mizzen, carried their sails unfurled from the yards as the square-rigged ship pounded away in the wintertime North Atlantic Ocean, bound from Ireland to New York. One of her passengers in steerage was Anne Carnick Maffitt, a gravid young woman whose time was nigh, traveling to join her husband, Reverend John Newland Maffitt, in Connecticut. As she lay in her small berth below decks, attended by women, she cried out for him, moaned for him, howled at times as if to drown out the banshee wind that blew over the sea. No longer could she tell how large the ocean swells were, or how often they were coming, or if the ship were bucking fore and aft, or twisting in opposite directions, or both. Her body seemed to be twisting and swelling on its own, and in her near delirium, she could no longer divide herself and her labors from those of the ship. "Are there storms on this ocean tonight?" Anne Maffitt asked. "No storms like the one within me," she answered. "Where is my husband, the preacher who has promised me heavens unceasing and a living world in motion forever and always?" The good Lord knew she had just now all the motion a body could want or stand. Where was the man with whom she plighted her troth, who pledged his love, and then saw his future not in Dublin, or even in Ireland, or England, anywhere, but in New England, on the ocean's far shore? Red skies at morning, red skies at night, warning to light, and blow ye winds hi-ho 10,000 miles away. When Anne Maffitt awakened, she held heaven in her arms, a baby boy, healthy of limb, breathing easily in time with her own breathing, wanting to sleep, yet also wanting to try out his fingers and his mouth upon her, hearing uncomprehending his first music, songs from Moore's melodies, from his mother's lips, flinching at the sharp hits of boot heels on the deck planking above. And if it were a rolling sea beyond the mother and child, she scarcely knew it, for she now felt a great calm, like that of a beautiful day dawning after a hurricane. And she heard faintly the sailors' exchanges on deck. "Steady as she goes, mate, steady as she goes." 3 months of sailing under all this canvas, and they would fetch up in America in the spring. The mother had, in those first moments of his life, named the baby boy for his absent father. Yet she already sensed, well before the 21st of April, when Reverend Maffitt came down the post road to meet them in the harbor of the city of New York, that somehow her babe, born at sea, might in a deeper way be allegiant to another, to whom someday he would be duty-bound. John Newland Maffitt, Jr. was a son of Neptune. So that's 1819. He was born on Washington's birthday. And from about the same time, here's an episode involving Moses Grandy, who's a generation older than Maffitt. New Begun Creek, Southern Pasquotank County, North Carolina. Christmas Eve and Christmas Day, circa 1820. For 2.5 years now, Moses Grandy had captained Mr. Truett's pair of canal boats between Elizabeth City and Norfolk. And now it was the night before Christmas, and Moses had just settled up with Truett at his waterside office in Elizabeth City for this most recent trip. Grandy had at last paid the man off. A second $600 gone to this second owner. A second bid for his freedom. And all he wanted to do right now was head back upriver to Enoch Sawyer's plantation in Camden and spend Christmas in the arms of his wife, God bless her. This is what he had slaved for. Yet Truett had something different in mind for Captain Grandy this evening. Truett needed to send him in the opposite direction, down the Pasquotank River to New Begun Creek to deliver a letter to Mr. William Muse there. The task was worth $2 to Moses Grandy if he would just do this one last thing for Mr. Truett. Another merchant, a man named Shaw, John Shaw, overheard the two men talking and walked into Truett's office. Shaw had a schooner laden at it and at anchor here at the Narrows, bound for New Begun Creek for Mr. Ambrose Knox there, and no one as yet to captain it downriver. Shaw offered $5 to Captain Grandy to make the transit. $7 Moses Grandy would have then, between Truett's and Shaw's money, to bring to his wife on Christmas Day, and she now carrying their child. So he took to the river, set sail on Shaw's craft, and made his way 8 miles downstream. When he reached New Begun Creek, most of a mile wide at its mouth, he lowered his sails and dropped anchor in the dark and waited for the waning cold moon to rise and light his way into the creek. Before long, moonlight flooded the river, laid a ribbon of water behind him, and cast a stark white light over the broad New Begun Bay before him. I wish I had more coat, he thought. $7, he thought. Captain Grandy raised his sails and got underway again. Coming into New Begun Creek from the river, he crossed a broad reach of nearly 2 miles, passing Palin's Creek to the north. Now he must ease around the north side of the creek to clear Jordan's Island, a squiggle of low land, just 100 feet long, set nearly in the middle of the stream, before the New Begun meanders began. The wharf he sought lay at the bottom of the third horseshoe bend, and moonlight led him right on into it. At the New Begun wharf, he docked at last, tied the schooner up fore and aft, and unloaded his cargo beneath the moon. Then the captain and his men slept heavy against the cold in the small ship's rude cabin, wrapped in old stiff blankets on the cabin floor. In the morning, Grandy got the goods safely conveyed to Ambrose Knox, and then he went on to his second task, delivering Mr. Truett's letter to Mr. William Templeman Muse, master of the great plantation Westmoreland and Pasquotank County's clerk of court as well. A thin sheet of ice lay across the black water this morning. No breeze stirred the Spanish moss in the cypress and gum trees. The New Begun swamp was cold and still, and walking up the plank path through the cypress, naked except for their clusters of seed pods, the cypress knees all about, Moses Grandy's footfall startled a deer, spooked it from under a fallen oak where it had slept, and the deer's exploding out from its bed in turn startled Moses and gave him a shake. Canada geese were flying and honking overhead, and the chit-chit of winter birds sounded through the woods. From a huge dead and debarked pine, a pileated woodpecker started at the man's approach and flew straight through the swamp thicket, not 10 feet in front of him, the Lord God bird. Grandy came up out of the swamp and onto the New Begun Road, entered the plantation lane 100 yards to the east. Morning sun will be good after that cold boat, these iced-up woods, and began a low, long, slow, half-mile walk south toward the farm's big house. This was Westmoreland, the former Virginian William Muse's Pasquotank County plantation paradise, getting torn out of this jungle, bit by bit, a 12-room house with verandas in the midst of 1,000 acres, and smokehouses and barns and a blacksmith's, and pear and peach, cherry and apple, and plum trees where before only blue iris flags and bluebell and yellow jasmine grew wild. Moses Grandy was striding up the narrow road, first in the long shade cast by the swamp woods, then with the rising eastern sun at his side toward the heart of the plantation, where a scuppernong vine covered 1/2 acre of ground, where in spring and summer the young white women sang, "Dogwood blossom on a cypress tree, if you want to kiss a pretty girl, come kiss me." No dogwood this cold Christmas morning, he thought, and no one for me to kiss, not yet, till back up the river to my wife in Camden. But this would not take long, he thought. Mr. Muse may ask Moses Grandy to wait long enough for Muse to draft a letter in reply. Or maybe not. The captain could be back at the New Begun Wharf casting off lines in an hour, With a fair breeze, he might make it upriver to town by early afternoon, get to his wife in Camden before dark. He might see her in the last Christmas daylight after all. He was still stiff from sleeping in that cold cabin shipboard, but the warmth of the sun felt good, and stretching his legs did too, as he drew closer and closer to the house at the head of the lane, at last reaching it and climbing a half dozen broad stairs, and now standing upon the veranda, holding his hat in one hand, the letter in the other, and knocking on the big unpainted front door. Presently he heard an iron latch slide within, and the door swung slowly open, and sunlight flooded the dark front hall. William Muse stood before him and beckoned him inside the hall, took the envelope from him, and opened it and withdrew the paper. "Well," Muse said, after slowly reading the letter, and then a second time, "well." "Yes, sir," said Moses Grandy. "You need me to wait?" "Moses, do you know what this letter says?" "No, sir. Mr. Truett just asked me to bring it to you, and it's sealed, and even if it wasn't, I can't read, and I wouldn't look at it nohow." "Yes, I know that. Everyone trusts you. What it says is that you now belong to me." "Belong? How?" asked Captain Grandy, shocked, his hand falling against a stair rail to steady himself. "What way?" "Don't you recall when Truett chartered Wilson Sawyer's brig to the West Indies?" "Of course I do." "At that same time," Muse told Grandy, "Truett borrowed $600 from him, given by Muse only after Truett signed a mortgage with Moses Grandy as the collateral for the note." "Yet Muse had thought all along," he allowed, "that Truett would fulfill his obligation, pay off this note." "I should not have taken a mortgage on you," Muse said to him. "I really thought Truett would take it up." But he had not, and now his business had failed, and William Muse was out $600 of good money. He must have hard cash or Grandy won, and there was no cash forthcoming for Truett. "I paid him. Paid him every cent I owed him. Over 2 years I paid him." So Grandy it was. A sudden vertiginous fury and grief overcame the captain, and a swoon of incredulity driving him back out into the Christmas daylight. What was $7 to take back to his wife now, when he had lost another $600, along with his freedom, because of an ill-begotten bargain between two other men, one of whom, Truett, had to have known, right when he was taking my last cash, that he and his business were doomed. How could he live? Moses Grandy flung himself out of Muse's home and ran crying, howling, stumbling across the stubble. And as he took to the thick woods, moaning among the cypress and pines and winter briars of the Newbegin morass over his own doom, he felt himself to be a crazed fool, cursed by God, wishing this wilderness swamp would open up and swallow him whole. Were he not delirious, he would be dead in his tracks, ruined by another man's ruin. However faithful he was, and long had been, however devotedly he moved the boats up and down the waterways, he would never be free. He was cheated, defrauded, stopped short again. Nothing would ever change. A man may as well let the briars shred his rough clothes, and then rip his shins, and then walk the 2 mile walk into the river beyond the jungle, and drown himself for once and all, and be done with this world. Yet he had a wife he loved. The cold morning sun lit the farm, the corn stubble stitching in the fields, and the piney woods all around. Moses Grandy staggered, stumbled, tripped into vine tangles, tried not to fall, wanted to fall, the weight on his chest a horror. Over his own cries, past the ragged choking he felt and heard in his throat, he heard, too, his footfalls in the sucking mud, and past that, he dreamt he heard his name, and knew he was worse than cursed by God. He was mocked by him. Another wilderness, another Moses, yet no tablets, no guidance, no promise of anything, this time except bondage upon bondage, endless into eternity and on beyond that. "Go on," he cried out, "go on. Burn me in that burning bush. Make me like salt. Smite me hip and thigh, and flood the whole wretched world again. Go on." And every time he caught his ragged breath, he heard his name on the light icy wind, and wanted God to find him here and be done with him. But it was not God calling. It was only William Muse's black manservant standing at the edge of the Newbegin swamp and crying out to him over and over, "Moses! Moses Grandy, come back." Captain Grandy wanted not to hear, feigned that he did not, until his fury settled coldly in his gut and his broken heart longed for his wife, and at last he did come back, limping now and his face bleeding, and he stumbled with the servant's help back up to the clerk of court's home, where inside from Muse, who now spoke slowly and formally to him, he learned his real fate. Mr. Enoch Sawyer, the customs collector in Camden, whose ferry Moses Grandy had run across the Pasquotank above the Narrows in years past, wanted to buy and own him. That was what else Truett let Muse know in the letter. Wanted Grandy to captain Sawyer's shingle and timber operations at the Great Dismal Swamp. Wanted Grandy to know that, should he refuse to submit, he might no longer approach or see his wife, still a slave at Sawyer's plantation, on the river. And if he tried to, he risked being flogged or shot. In no time, Moses Grandy would belong to Enoch Sawyer. How could he go back to Enoch Sawyer's plantation and tell all this to his wife? Regardless of what Captain Grandy had earned and was due, the mute cypress lining the waterways bearing witness on his behalf as he soon sailed bitterly back out the creek to the river. This was what he had gotten. Christmas had come to New Begun Creek. Christmas had come to the Albemarle. Christmas had come to Moses Grandy.